We will be speaking into a microphone today because we are using assistive listening devices for anyone that has a particularly difficult time hearing. So, have we given them all out yet, Bob? Okay. If anybody needs an assistive listening device, we have a few of them. So, if you want to raise your hand, Bob is in the back here. And we can guide them to you if necessary. Is there anybody who wants one? You'll miss the whole service if you need one and you don't say yes now. Just being honest. All right, we also have a couple of deacons. Fish and Meg are both in the rear here. So Fish and Meg, if you raise your hands. Fish is just in the back here. Meg is back here. If you need anything, they will help you. Welcome to Jackson Community Church. We are here for a bittersweet reason, which is to celebrate a woman that we love, who is so vital and so important. First, to her family, to her beloved John, to her children, her grandchildren, and when I say children, I mean everybody that has been part of her family, to her sister, to her nieces and nephews, and to this wider community, to whom she has been so many different things. Today, through the words of her friends and her family, we will reflect just a little bit on all that she has been, Mary, to us. We know that each person who is here has your own story about how you have known and loved Mary, and how you have celebrated being her friend, and how she has touched your life. We will only begin to tell these stories, and we know that they're going to keep coming out for a long time, but we are just beginning to say goodbye to her. But today we begin. Please join me in a space of prayer by simply being quiet with me as I read this meditation from Wendell Berry. We have kept to the way that we chose in love, without foresight and long ago. It has come to light only in the daylight of each day, as that day has come, out of many possibilities one. An old house, renewed upon its slope, a lawn bringing in from garden, fields and woods, not to be hurried or increased. We have kept a daily faithfulness to these, to one another, and to this difficult, beautiful place, arriving here again and again out of distance, weariness, or disappointment, to take it by surprise. It is an old road that we have followed, little improved by the passage of forebears, yet always renewed by growth of the trees that lean over it, by weather never 2 days the same, and by our own delight to see that it has led us once again to an opening, a small, cultivated valley among the wooded hills, familiar as the oldest stream, where we know we are, even as we do, the work of love. Mary's life is sacred, and her love is a living prayer. And we give thanks for the life that she lived and the love that she shared with all of us. Let us pray together. This will probably be the most and only traditional part of the service that you will recognize as religious, per Mary. But we will do the Lord's Prayer together. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever. Amen. The way that I knew Mary was not particularly religious. It was a lot. lot more about poetry and conversation and art and the cares of this world and this village. We are going to be sharing music by Wayne Keeley. And Wayne, you can introduce the songs that you're playing and explain why they're important. It's all guitar music except for when Alicia is playing piano for us. And then readings and reflections by family and friends.
Short pieces in classical style. Mary studied classical television for the last few years. That was a real joy. She was a friend. She was a serious student. We shared a lot of common joys and adventures together. So during the lesson, it was the music embellished a lot. And Mary would share some of her stories, and I'd say some lines. We found that we had common ancestors in Normandy, France, and I was studying French once again, trying to be able to speak it just a little bit. And what that led to us, and she would correct me on my pronunciation, which I needed, and I would correct her on her notes. So they would go back and forth. The teacher would be involved to left the right seat. But the first piece is a piece that I saw Andrew Segovia. And Crystal Pye, who I studied with, played many times as their encore piece. And it would be at the end of the concert, and it was, so nobody would put it best to me and say, I would play longer for you, but my guitar is getting tired. And he would end it that way, and I'll play another piece. But the word encore, I think, is the tribute here, because again, a French word, and the translation again is again. And someday, I hope that we can play our guitars together again. Thank you.
doing. So again, if you didn't catch that, Wayne is Mary's guitar teacher. And the next time that he plays, he'll be playing on Mary's guitar. Janice, if you will come to start us off.
Can you hear me?
Yeah.
Mary would be delighted, just delighted. So this is in memory of my friend, Mary Howe. The phone rang December 4th. I answered and heard the most ridiculous piece of news told to me in years. Anne called to tell me Mary had died quite suddenly from a heart attack. I came to a full stop. I couldn't comprehend it. My voice left me and my brain shut down. I didn't understand. I heard myself think, what do you mean? Mary can't be gone. We had plans. I had plans for both of us. Mary and I met at Melanie's Gallery almost 10 years ago, as artists found beauty worthy of expressing on canvas and paper. But it wasn't all beer and Skittles. In the beginning, we verbally circled each other, trying to figure out just what our politics were. After a few veiled exchanges about the 2008 presidential election, it was clear that we shared some common ground, but we still had a ways to go. She had questions, and I had answers. In 2012, we were on solid ground. Solid enough to attend the state Democratic convention together and relish every minute while being part of one of the largest turnouts in the party's recorded history. Looking back, I'm not sure how or exactly when we became friends, but we did. Real friends and partners in crime. Stirring up trouble for something we cared about came easily to both of us. Together, there was no telling what we could do with enough time and a very small amount of money. Perhaps change the world, or at the very least, change Jackson. We had potential. Mary became part of my New Hampshire posse, and I loved it. I am so grateful that she was in my life. Mary helped restore my faith in humanity. No small thing during these times. I love her curiosity, her willingness to learn, and her courage facing so many hard truths. Whether it was hearing me talk about the insidiousness of racism, or coming to terms with her husband's illness. Her fragility was her toughness. Aside from our shared love for politics, art, and activism, we liked to knit. She graciously endured my halting French that had been lying dormant on my tongue for decades. I mean decades. And although she was in her early 80s, she seemed ageless to me, with her twinkling blue eyes and bright white hair. Deep down in some other life, I suspected she had been an elf. The Mary I knew had a loving, thankful, patient heart. She was a fighter. And I miss her terribly. She occupied a vital place in my heart and in my life. My world world is now a little darker without her in it, but more hopeful because of her. I know we'll meet again. And when we do, she'll tell me about all of her adventures and show me the most magnificent painting she's ever done. Until then, I'll look for her shining brightly in the night sky, traveling in an ocean breeze caught in a wave, walking among fields of flowers that have yet to be named, and whispering in French through the silence of freshly fallen snow to let me know how she is. Thank you, Mary. You touched my heart and soul.
Will you see Reese if you'll come up? Reese is Mary's daughter. Reese is her spouse.
I may enter into a crying section. they say that, I've heard a rumor that not everyone enjoys their mother-in-law. I looked down. I got married. Just a big crying part. Our son, which are good, his grandchild. And she informed us that maybe she didn't love being called then Mary. She wanted something else. So now I'm going to name her Magpie, which she loved. To the point where at times later, when I would call her Mary, she would say, "What's wrong with Magpie?" And she was Magpie-like in many ways, as many of you know. She could be punky. She could be tame. She could be puckish for sure. And trying to find things when she had them can also be difficult. But being with Mary could also be like this poem, which, Wayne, takes place somewhere in southern France in the 50s. It was written by a classmate of John's, W.S. Merwin. But this is as close as I can come to what being with Mary was like. It's called Present. She informed me, you know that Mirabelles are little plums, if you don't know that. She informed me that she had a tree of Mirabelles, told me it was the only one anywhere around. She did not want everyone to realize she had it. It might go for years and bear nothing at all, flowering with the other plums, but then nothing. In another year, it would be covered with Mirabelles. You know, they're not so big as all the others, but they're more delicate for those acquainted with them. She promised me Mirabelles if it was the year for them. She lived in a house so small, she mustn't be able to reach anything from where she was, and her garden was scarcely larger. She grew corn salad in winter after Brussels sprouts. Well, it was a cold garden facing north, so it was slow in spring, better for summer. One of the not gray trees leaning against the wall to the south was a Mirabelle. A snow of plum blossoms swept across the valley in the morning sunlight of a day in March and moved up the slope hour by hour. She told me later she thought it would be a year of Mirabelles, unless it froze. When she bent in her garden, she disappeared in the rows. It took her a long time to stand up, to turn around, to let herself through the gate, to walk, to do anything. "At my age, I have all I need," she said, "if I keep warm." Late one day that summer, she appeared at the wall, carrying a brown paper bag, wet at the bottom. "The Mirabelles," she whispered, but she would not come in. We sat on the wall and opened the bag. "Look," she said, "how you can see through them." And each of us held up a small golden plum filled with the summer evening.
My mother didn't talk much about her childhood while we were growing up. The first school project, her grandson Sam interviewed her one year. Her responses were illuminating. Here are some of the excerpts of what she had to say to his questions. I was sent to boarding school at 7 years old because my mother could not control me. It was a boarding school with nuns. We mostly wore black dresses, stockings, and shoes. What went under the dress seemed really medieval, as I think about it now. The pensionnat de Saint-Anne had a huge fenced-in park, a wonderful playground, but there was also a large indoor recreation room. Sometimes when the nuns were desperate, they put on marching band records and we marched. One winter, I was captain of a huge snow fort. We made at least 100 snowballs and took turns throwing them at the other team's fort. We smashed them to bits. I probably enjoyed singing the best. I took a train to school, but I didn't go home very often during the school year. In the summer, I played outside. I especially remember a neighbor who kept a cow in the field next to our house. When I saw him coming to milk her, I dove under the barbed wire fence and ran as fast as I could to watch him. When there was enough snow to ski, my father and I would pack up a frying pan and a jar of crepe batter and set off for a long trek. Somewhere in the woods, we would collect kindling, build a fire, and cook up some crepe. Whenever I came home, my mother made ratatouille, which I ate with my eggs for breakfast. I loved the way she prepared beef tongues sliced with raisins or mustard sauce. In the summer, she made cold tongue salad prepared like potato salad. On Sundays, we had leg of lamb. One day a week, the village bakery, which baked their breads in brick ovens, made fresh, hot cream puffs you could smell all over the village. All the kids would go there with their 25 cents. Foreshadowing the rest of her life, she ended her responses by saying, I think I'd say I spent all the time I could outside exploring.
Andy's sensory written blood come up. Andy is John's son and Mary's son in spirit and heart. Whitney and Spencer are her grandchildren. All over.
Hello. I have a poem adapted from William Percy French. When painters leave this world, we grieve for the hand that will work no more. But who can say that they rest always on that still celestial shore? No, they choose from the rainbow hues, and winging from heaven, they come to paint, bold and faint, the tones of our sunset skies. When I see them there, I can almost swear that crimson flush was Mary's brush.
Do not stand at my grave and weep. I am not there. I do the thousand winds that blow. I'm the diamond glints on the snow. I'm the sunlight on ripened grain. I'm the gentle autumn rain. When you awaken in the morning hush, I'm the swift, uplifting rush. Of quiet birds in circled flight, I am the soft stars that shine at night. Do not stand at my grave and cry. I am not dead. I did not die. Mary Elizabeth Cry.
I have a few stories. We all knew Mary from different perspectives and life experiences, giving each of us a bundle of memories. We've heard some of them here today already. I have an early memory of seeing Mary and John whisking into the annual family Christmas gathering at the greenhouse in Wellesley, newly married or to be married or something. It really didn't matter to my brother Matt and me, as we were 5 and 7 and more interested in the toys in Aunt Harriet's next room. But it appeared that we now had a stepmother. We already knew Mary from her association with Overlook. She had become friends with our mother, who taught her to drive a VW Bug in the parking lot of an apartment in the Boston area. Mother still remembers it as a horrifying experience. Mary did become a better driver, but in later years, many of us may at times have taken issue with that qualification. In 1964, Matt and I traveled to Alaska with our grandmother, Marjorie Howe, to visit John, Mary, Cuppy, and Jackson, the family husky. What other kind of dog would you have in Alaska? This was one of our very first quality times with Mary, and looking back on it, I think it's fair to say that she was the whirlwind activities director for our visit. I don't really remember how long we stayed, but we did an awful lot. Painting the doghouse, panning for gold, a paddle wheel trip on a local river, loading into the VW bus for a camping trip down to Valdez to look at the earlier year's earthquake damage, visiting all of her friends, eating a few strange things, exploring a whole new environment. After a few moves, they eventually made it back to Jackson. Matt and I began more regular visits on weekends and school vacation weeks. Mary always worked to give us a second home, and we enjoy the times with our sisters, doing what kids do around Jackson and Overlook: hikes, swimming in the river, skiing and snowshoeing, building snow forts. There were lots of animals, barnyard and otherwise, so it was always entertaining. I remember occasional fly fishing with Mary and John as a kid, Mary sporting a corncob pipe to match John's to keep the black flies away. Hand-painted postcards randomly appeared in the mail from the many places they lived and visited. Mary fulfilling her artistic bent as she described in quick notes and brush strokes all the adventures of her life. I wish I'd been a better collector, as some of those postcards and notes were quite stunning miniature watercolors. It is great that she had the time, energy, and support to more fully develop that talent in recent years. Fast forward a lot of years to close out with this painting theme. As my wife Gay likes to say about leaving our then young children with Mary, we never knew if they'd be fed or if their diapers would be changed, but we always knew they would have a wonderful time. One summer day, I was away on a trip, and she had left Whitney and Spencer, they were maybe 6 and 3, with Mary for the day at our house of Kittery. When Gay returned later in the afternoon, she found the bathroom an explosion of color, finger paint everywhere, with Mary standing in the middle of it all in her underwear. She and the children were covered from head to toe in finger paint, both all of them smiling and chuckling. As Mary said, they wanted to paint me, so I loved it. Of course, they had a fantastic day with their grand nurse. Paint in peace, Mary.
Wayne is going to play us a couple of songs on Mary's guitar.
I think it would be very fitting to play on Mary's guitar, because she played it so well, and I tell you a little story about how we came to this point with this guitar. You heard my Rivera's guitar, which is a booming sound, big guitar. I don't take the lessons because the students always say, well, you sound good because you have a nice guitar. So I always bring a lesson guitar with me and play it as hard as I can and then work at the guitar. So Mary's coming in with a lesson guitar and she's studying and she probably says, but I want to get something that sounds better. So she wanted to move up to a cordobera. It was beyond her price range at times. So I was playing a lag in the studio, which is a guitar made in France. Mm-hmm. So Mary thought, well, I can get this lag in price, you know, this is it. And she had the guitar, and I said, well, if we get to see the top, it will be close to it. She said, but I'm not going to have the sound. I said, it will. I said, because guitar is like us, Mary. Get better with age. And if you play it, and even now, guitars have to be played, they will speak. If you don't play them, they have to be played. It resonates. And this goes with all the guitars. So with that, she got the lag. And then every week would say to me, how does this sound? And I say, wow, it's getting better with age. And I would play a little bit on it each time. Well, with that in mind, I had a couple pieces that she was studying with me. She played these pieces. And again, French titles. The first one's Desiree. And with Desiree, it was by Maria Lindman, who I played in my last piece, Whispering to You. I said, what does it make you think of? And I said, you and you're the painter. And I said, it makes me think of that famous Monet painting, the dancing couple with such, and we visualize that. And I said, Mary, what's it make you think of? She said, the thing is very French impressions, the painting. And I think for now, seeing that painting right there of Mary, painting her apple blossoms, I think that's what this song is about. Thank you.
I loved Mary.
Mary and I became friends fairly quickly. Although at first she wondered why I would befriend her, since she was 20 years older than I. Once she asked me, "Why do you want to spend time with me? Is it that you need a mother?" I responded that I had had a mother and that I did not need another one. Two of the reasons, I explained, were that we had so many things in common and that I liked her. While we shared common interests, such as classical guitar, art, sailing, and in French, what I loved most about Mary was her young heart and curious mind. She always wanted to do things with me which reminded her of times past when she was not as homebound by life circumstances. We had recently started going on short hikes together. The first was a trail leading to the summit of a small mountain off Dundee Road. I could tell that she was easily getting fatigued and that her balance was not the best. I found her a walking stick, and she insisted on plowing ahead, even after I kept telling her that it did not matter to me if we didn't make it to the top, and that if she did wish to continue, she could take as many rests as she wanted. I was simply happy to be in the woods with her, and so was she. But plow ahead she did, and her pride and pleasure at reaching the top was evident. It gave me great joy to be able to share in her happiness. From then on, she started getting in better shape, working in her garden, and so on. And she kept wanting to schedule other hikes. Another time, we took most of the day going up Black Mountain. I did not expect us to finish the hike, since it was more arduous, but she insisted on wanting to continue to the top, which worried me at times, but I was not one to put a damper on her free spirit. I have a fond memory of her foraging for mushrooms along the way and teaching me the ins and outs of mushroom picking. And she did make it up all the way to the Black Mountain cabin. The hike down took a long time as well, but again, we were happy to be in the woods together as she shared her love and knowledge of nature. Mary will be with me. The memories that I have of our short friendship will stay with me and accompany me for the rest of my life. To have known Mary and to have been given the gift of her friendship has been and still is so meaningful to me. Mary will live on in my heart and mind forever. Authentic, loving, full of spirit, adventuresome, curious, fearless Mary. I love you, Mary.
Jeanine Lopez, this family member.
My printer was not working, so I'm using my iPhone. Hello, my name is Jeanine Lopez. I want to thank you for being here to celebrate and to remember our wonderful Aunt Mary. My mom is Anique Lopez, Mary's younger sister, and I am the youngest of four nieces and nephews. My Aunt Mary left for college and became a New Englander, and my mom grew up in Key West, Florida, and became a Southerner. However, they reconnected in 1985. With my very first ski trip, visiting Outlook. The bathrooms were a bit cold. The sheep chased us through the fields. However, the house was warm with the wood-burning stove. Uncle John playing his horn to get us up in the morning. Aunt Mary was always very warm and affectionate, with an all-knowing smile and those piercing blue eyes. She appreciated everyone she met and all of God's creatures in the woods behind her house. Thank God Mom and Dad pitched in for that lawnmower so she could find them. Her garden was indescribable, with giant, gnarling horseradishes that were as tall as she was. This is not saying much, because she was only 5 foot. My mom only being 5'3". Feisty, stubborn are words that describe her, determined and caring. She hated leaf blowers, which my father used regularly, in Alabama, of course. In closing, please appreciate those around you daily. Give them a hug. This is my crying moment. Be fearless. We will never know what the surprises of tomorrow will bring. We were fortunate that Mary visited my mother in September. She actually went down. My father runs a golf tournament every year that raises about $175,000 for the Catholic schools in the area. And Mary was good enough to go down and spend some time for that, probably last year that they ran the event. So my mom did get to spend time with her. Unfortunately, she didn't get to make the ceremony today, but she's here in spirit as well. So thank you.
And finally, Gus and Cuppy. Cuppy is Mary's daughter. Gus is her grandson.
Remember me. To the living, I am gone. To the sorrowful, I will never return. To the angry, I was cheated. But to the happy, I am at peace. And to the faithful, I have never left. I cannot be seen, but I can be heard. So as you stand upon a shore, gazing at a beautiful sea, remember me. As you look in awe at a mighty forest and its grand majesty, remember me. As you look upon a flower and admire its simplicity, remember me. Remember me in your heart, your thoughts, your memories of the times we loved, the times we cried, the times we fought, the times we laughed. For if you always think of me, I will never be gone.
Thank you all for being here today. My humble mother would have been so honored and genuinely surprised at this heartwarming turnout. Mom was raised in a French-speaking, staunchly Catholic household. She loved her parents, but they were very strict and didn't appreciate her creativity and spunk. As you've heard, when she was quite young, they sent her off to a boarding school in Quebec, where she wore a pinafore, and Lucy and I like to imagine led a life similar to the children's book character, Madeline. She spent her formative years in Quebec, and then Denver, and by the time she got to Pembroke for college, Mom was ready to spread her wings and shake things up. She told us often how much she loved the New England weather when she first came east, Being outdoors on a bracing fall day made her feel alive. Mum delighted in being outside in any kind of weather, working in her garden, tending to her animals, hiking in these glorious mountains, sailing with our father, painting in orchards, swimming with her mask and snorkel in any ocean, lake, or river she encountered. She was always up for an adventure, always curious, and always ready to claim a new passion. Lucky us to be alone for the ride. Our earliest memories revolve around doing creative things with her, drawing, painting, cooking, gardening. In those days, she'd often take us on grand adventures to Cambridge or Boston, usually accompanied by one of her cherished friends and their children. We'd visit the design research store, wander the downtown streets, or explore a museum. She loved the excitement and energy of the big city. Being with Mom was always fun. She was truly a child at heart, even into her 80s. She taught us how to live our lives to the fullest and to never shy away from a challenge. She was forever learning new things, listening to new people, and dreaming up new plans. Of course, the consequence of her always whirling brain was that she had a tendency to be a bit scattered. She didn't spend much time worrying about trivial things like house cleaning or childcare. We were more often than not the last kids to be picked up after school, and we were the students most likely to find something unusual in our lunchbox. Mackerel sandwiches come to mind. As we turned the corner into our teen years, we were sometimes acutely embarrassed by our mother, who would do things like order a brassiere burger from Dairy Queen or a pizza pie from the Italian restaurant. Every summer at Overlook, we would move from the big house up the hill to the little house. We can't even count the number of times we climbed our old Volkswagen bus at the bottom of the hill because Mom had forgotten to put the parking brake on. Those of you who have lived in Jackson for a long time will remember her love of animals. She had quite a menagerie. Sheep, pigs, goats, chickens, geese, pigeons, rabbits, guinea pigs, cats, dogs. At one point, we had a sparrowhawk, Noel, who she found at the top of Black Mountain with a broken wing. She raised mice in an old aquarium in our kitchen, and she fed Noel their tiny pink babies until his wing healed and he could return to the wild. We also remember brief visits by a woodcock and a very sweet baby skunk, not to mention the many motherless piglets and lambs who took up residence in our cozy kitchen until they were healthy enough to live out in the barn and the fields on their own. Most recently, Mom had embraced the challenge of raising her sweet puppy, Gigi, who brought so much joy into her life. Mom was very active in town. She was on the school board and the conservation commission. Politics always got her riled up. And for one week in the late 90s, she joined political activist Granny E as she marched across the country in support of campaign finance reform. She loved a good political discussion and encouraged her grandchildren to stay informed so that she could talk to them about what was going on in the world. Her 7 grandchildren were probably her favorite humans on this earth. She was an extraordinary grandmother. She was interested in whatever they were interested in, and she was so proud of each of them. In their eyes, she never seemed to grow old. They will always remember her beautiful, sparkling blue eyes and her youthful excitement about everything going on in their world. I hope we can each leave here today carrying a little bit of my mother's spark inside of us. Try to be inquisitive and brave in everything you do. Embrace your passions, take good care of your friends and family, and always, always respect the earth. Thank you. So most of us, in fact, none of us really got a chance to say goodbye to Mary. And so today is our goodbye. And as humans, ritual helps us create a space for both celebration, but also allows us to be sad. It's hard when somebody dies, no matter how many wonderful years they gave us and how well their ending passed. We need time and space to be allowed to be sad too, as well as grateful for Mary's life. Today, we're going to place green boughs here on this table, right by Mary's remains and her limber boots and one of her paintings, and just celebrate having known her and giving each of you a chance to say goodbye. We're going to begin by letting her family come up and place a green bough. And you can say a word as you lay down the bough. It can be completely silent. And then we're going to invite all of you to come forward. We'll bring you up one row at a time. We're going to have everybody rotate this way because this is a little skinny aisles. And we've tried it with chaos, which would be Mary's way of doing things. It would be a beautiful chaos, but maybe not so friendly to all of our bodies. So the family come forward and they go back to their seats, but then we're going to have everybody go this way. chose this music because John loves this music. And these boughs were cut from Overlook, I believe. So they come from here. And they are part of what Mary loved about this place. And we thank you for giving her back the boughs that give her so much joy. We, on the request of the family, we're going to close with a Christmas carol, Silent Night, and a benediction. Then her grandchildren and nieces and nephews will ring the bell, and then we'll invite you all back for John's favorite food, which I believe is cookies. And there's enough cookies to feed all of Jackson, so you can fill your pockets or your stomach or something with cookies, and they are beautiful in all kinds. If you need to stretch your legs, you can rise for Silent Night. Should we do that? Children and her nieces and nephews would stand up and go to the front, please, and ring the bell. I'm going to Tish with a toothbrush. I'm going to open the front door so that everybody else can hear it, you guys. Once we hear the bell ring, then we'll start letting everybody go for cookies.
Thank you.